So, good afternoon. Like I said, everyone, my name is Dr. Marlon Johnson, and I am the chair of the Professional Development Committee here with Counselors for Social Justice. And I am here with two wonderful presenters who are helping us to think more intentionally about our relationship, our mandate, and to be more active and engaged with our work within disability culture in counselor education. So, today's presentation is a call to action, embracing disability culture in counselor education. So, I would love to share a quick bio and then I will be right out of your way. So, we have our two presenters today. And first, we have Ms. Olivia Fadul, who is a counselor education and supervision doctoral student at the University of New Mexico. As a counselor, she is committed to helping her clients find their truth, identity, strength, and power. As a second-generation Filipino-American woman living with a disability, her life journey and early hearing loss at age 5 led her to become a counselor, disability advocate, and researcher focused on diversity, equity, inclusion, and access. She is a proud owner of a telehealth business called Olive Tree Counseling and Wellness. In her doctoral program, Olivia founded the University of New Mexico's Deaf and Hard of Hearing Peer Support Group, which serves on local disability boards. She also serves on local disability boards, forgive me, and is the president-elect of New Mexico Counselor Advocacy and Social Justice, and is also on the American Rehabilitation Counselors Association Task Force, where she worked on the founding Conference Accessibility Resource Report Guide to guide the American Counseling Association conferences and divisions. Olivia's primary research focus is disability identity and ensuring equitable access for students, counselors, and professors with disabilities. We also have with us Dr. Lynn Pierce. And Dr. Pierce is an assistant professor of counseling at Mercer University. Currently, she serves her university as program coordinator for the PhD in counselor education and supervision. As a disabled academic, her advocacy work focuses on improving access in the counseling profession for clients and for counselors and counselor educators in training. She is also co-chair of the Disability Justice and Accessibility Committee within the ACES Diversity and Inclusion Interest Network, as well as one of the guiding forces of the ARCA Accessibility Report Guide. Dr. Pierce has previously consulted on access for face-to-face and virtual programming for MBCC and Chi Sigma Iota. She's developed accessibility considerations for the Chi Sigma Iota Initiation Guide and chairs the NARACIS Accessibility Committee. Thank you both so much for all the work that you do, and we look forward to learning so much more from you all today.
Thank you. So I think we were just going to take a couple of minutes to highlight a few things from our bio. Olivia, do you want to lead us off?
Yes. So I'm happy to be here. I am so happy to have this opportunity, and my life journey has led me to be a academic, and I'm a little nervous. So Lynn, I'm gonna pass this off to you just to be very transparent.
All right, all good. So I think, you know, you've got some bullet points up here. Honestly, most of it was in our bios. I do consider myself a disabled academic, and for transparency up front, want to just put it right out there that I've got a physical disability, mobility impairments, and consider myself to primarily align with CRIP culture within the disability community. So we're going to be talking a little bit about different community perspectives and voices, and we hope that we're going to share a variety, but certainly our positionality does very much so enter into into that. And so want to be really transparent right off the bat that that's going to be a little bit of the focus, just to do a deep dive there, which is where, you know, I am most able to speak to that kind of interaction. So gonna quickly walk us through the learning objectives. So we only have an hour, and we actually had this conversation before, because I feel like so often I'm doing these presentations myself or with others, and you feel a lot of pressure, right? And I'm sure you all are thinking of your own topics, whether you do CEs, whether you do these kind of webinars, you always feel a lot of pressure to like teach everybody everything. And so we are well aware that we are not going to solve ableism in the profession in the next hour, or it would already be solved, right? So what we want to really do is give a kind of high level overview of some of these concepts, get you maybe a little bit more terminology. Hopefully you find some resources and some references that interest you, and you're able to do more of this exploration on your own. And our contact information is at the end, and we are both very, very willing to continue in these conversations with you. So that's how I'd like to kind of position us going in here. So we want to get through some of the key concepts and definitions related to disability, as well as disability prevalence, kind of why that matters for counseling, for counselor ed, counselors in training. We're going to briefly go through the disability justice principles that frame social justice work for disability equity. So these really mesh well with other DEI efforts and multicultural competencies, but they're not discussed very much. So we do want to expose you to those. And then we'll also be covering some resources, including the ARCA accessibility report that you already heard a little bit about, and you'll hear much more about, the disability related competencies, counseling competencies, and just other resources and things that can be in your toolkit.
So I'm very happy to have this flag. This is the disability flag. I don't know if you knew that our culture has a disability flag. And so been hard of hearing since age 5. And it took me a while to really come into my identity. I've always been deaf and hard of hearing. However, in my profession and clinical mental health, for a long time, I hid my identity of who I was because I didn't see myself in clinical mental health research. So I want to be one of the first disability activists within academic literature, and I'm very proud to be an academic. And so this is my flag. And so the flag was created in 2014. So if you could please very briefly put in the chat why learn about disability and disability culture in cancer education. Why is that important? And just want to let you know that Anne McGill, this is Anne McGill's artwork, and she is a disabled artist. And the flag is important because it highlights multiple experience and identifies diversity in disability community with different colors representing various disabilities. In 2010, Anne attended the American with Disabilities Act. It was an event in 2010, and she was disappointed that the celebration was confined to the basement and grounds of a regional independent living center instead of out in public. She said that she always wanted a disability flag. So in 2019, she created the first disability flag. In 2021, the flag was updated to subtle colors, and the disability flag colors, it symbolizes the various types of disability. Green symbolizes sensory disability. Blue symbolizes emotional and psychiatric disability. White stands for non-visible and undiagnosed disability. Gold is for neurodiversity. And red represents physical disabilities. And with that said, I will pass this over to Lynn.
Great. So I did put the prompt in the chat. If you would like to engage with that, we'll kind of come back around to that as we lay out some of the whys that we could think of for counselor education based in the general research, our experiences. And while you are typing some of that, I think Olivia was going to give us just a brief little overview of some of the work that we've been doing on the ARCA Accessibility Task Force. And this really has been an effort very much helmed by Olivia. So I will step out of her way and let her explain a little bit of what we've been doing.
So this was born in my first year of doctoral program. I wanted more access in counselor education. My advisor is Dr. Christopher Goodrich, and Dr. Goodrich, he was advising me one day, and he said, "Why don't you go to ARCA?" And you know, for a while, it took me about 2 months until I came around. So I belong to ARCA, Council for Social Justice, saw a few other organizations, but I didn't really see myself in research. And so Dr. Goodrich was like, "Well, why don't you join ARCA?" And I did. And so I reached out to Dr. Sonia Peterson, and Dr. Sonia Peterson said, "Well, why don't you do the ARCA Accessibility Task Force?" And so that's how it's born. And so I was so excited to finally have something around access. And it can't, and you know, the funny part is sometimes when you need stuff the most, it pops up in your life. And so it's going through a very hard time. And I met Lynn, and then I met Dr. Hartley, and I met Tony, and we got together. We created the ARCA Accessibility Task Force, and so we work on accessibility and programming in counseling education. We want accessible conferences, accessible education, and our passion is advocating for disabled students, professors, and clients. So we advocate for disability cultural competency, allyship, and responsive care in counseling. And we also operate from a disability affirming framework in teaching and counseling. And so we're continuing to build a disability affirmative counseling education. And here you will see our ARCA guide. And so the ARCA Accessibility Task Force is online. You can access that online. And we also have, you see below, we also have an example of how when you do PowerPoints, you put the image description when you put a picture. And so this is our love recipe to cancer education in the disability community. And with further ado, I'm going to pass this off to Lynn.
So Olivia actually found this quote. Yeah. And just kind of moving through quickly, I think, you know, we want these slides to be a reference for people. So you will be able to come back and kind of engage with some of these things. But I think this is something that frames a lot of the conversation in a very disability justice and community affirming kind of way. So a pathway of reflective solidarity, democratic dialogue, really this sense of a collective struggle within disability community spaces. You know, we talk about self-preservation in some of the advocacy work that we do. And this sense of community, I think, is really what stands out to me lately in my work in terms of where we could be going that would be more sustainable and just more welcoming and inclusive for people with disabilities and disabled counselors, counselor educators. Olivia, anything else you want to say about this piece?
I think you covered it. And I found this quote and I was so excited to include it. And Lynn, you covered this amazingly. We're ready to go to the next slide.
Great. So I don't want to do a disability 100. And honestly, I've been watching what people have been putting in the slides in the chat on why this is important. And it sounds like we are all on the same page, right? That this is really an equity issue, that this is something that needs more attention. It sounds like there's some held identity in the space, which I'm so thankful for. Thank you all for coming. And so I just want to do the really quick rundown on a few things, make sure we're using the same definitions and on the same page. And then some of these topics are what we're going to spend the majority of our time here in the next half hour or so before we get to, you know, some tools and some questions, really, really doing a deeper dive on. So accessibility and accommodations. If we start clear back with disability, Olivia and I, for most of this presentation, will be using a definition somewhat in line with the ADA guidance. So a disability is any condition that affects one or more life activities. A life activity could be everything from breathing to walking to reading, right? So it's a pretty broad definition. In terms of accessibility and accommodations, so a lot of my work is in accessibility and accommodations space, and these tend to get used interchangeably. They are not, particularly if we're talking about public access, anything outside of employment. Accessibility is something that is federally mandated, and really with very few exceptions, spaces should be accessible. Unfortunately, we're finding that often within counseling practice, counseling conferences, you know, university settings, we're finding that often this is not the case. The standard of access has not always been met. So that's something that should be there and is not always. Accommodations are something that is a change in how a program functions based typically on the direct request of somebody who has a disability need. So this is something like a sign language interpreter at a conference. May or may not be an ASL interpreter on site unless somebody has indicated the need for that particular service. So what we're really advocating, I think, across the board, you know, all of the task force members in all of our advocacy, is moving away from this very outdated and accommodations focused mindset that a lot of the organizations seem to have, where the question is always, well, what must we do? What do we have to do not to get sued? Getting the bare minimum that is required under federal law is a really, really hard way to live and thrive and function and contribute to the profession, right? So we're really trying to go toward this universal design and barrier reduction model, which really asks, what can we do? It says, if we can foresee a barrier, if we know that the door to the bathrooms in the hotel that we're at for this conference is too heavy, then can we prop it and put a sign on the door that says this door is propped for access, please do not close it, right? So it's this proactive approach rather than the very reactive approach that we really see with an accommodations mindset, where either there's waiting for a request or there's waiting for a problem. So the same thing happens in the classroom. Universal Design for Learning is a great model that really talks about multiple methods of engagement and proactively determining what barriers there might be. So for instance, I know from working in disability services for about 4 years that the vast majority of requests I'm going to get are test related. It's going to be extra time or a quiet environment or, you know, things along those lines. And so if I can give that test asynchronously online with no time limit and maybe a chance for a repeat, all of a sudden I've eliminated a lot of the potential needs for accommodations. And unless there's a very strong reason in line with my learning objectives why that test needs to be very high stakes and timed and proctored, generally that's what I'm going to do in my instruction, right? So it's kind of flipping the script and figuring out how can we make this a more usable environment for everybody is the goal of a universal design sort of approach. We're going to talk about disability culture, ableism and ability privilege, disability justice kind of approaches and access intimacy more in depth. The only thing I want to say about disability culture before we get there in a few slides is that it is a culture. And I know that a lot of people aren't thinking of disability as a culture. It's an extraordinarily diverse culture, which is why intersectionality is important, because we're going to talk about the prevalence and some other pieces here. There's lots and lots and lots of different kinds of people who have disabilities, and there's lots and lots of kinds of disabilities, and there's many ways to experience each and every one of those disabilities given all of the factors that are on the table. However, there are some shared pieces of language, shared history, shared oppression and experiences, right? And some of those things that tie a community together. We'll also look a little bit at some art, which is another major part of disability culture in addition to language.
So why does disability matter in counselor education? Just like Lynn said, we come from a diverse background. There's people from many different nationalities. And for myself, one of the common things I get a lot is, you don't look like somebody that is disabled. And so when I wear my hair up, you can see my hearing aid, but if I have it down, I can cover my disability. And so that's something I do not want to do anymore. I want to be open. I want to share my story because I realized by doing that, that takes away from somebody's care that needs that. I feel like invisible disabilities or non-apparent disabilities, they don't get the care that they need. So it's very important to meet, build the counseling competency within our field, because 27 million individuals in the United States identify as, some identify and some do not, but within the CDC, there's 27 million disabled individuals. And NIH, if you do not know this, NIH is starting to recognize disability. And there's been a lot of progress within the field. However, there still needs to be more progress that happens. And so the goal within counseling education, at least my goal, is to decrease ableism and improve care for the largest minority. And this task force is one of the flagships that I am very proud of within our profession. So we want to increase disabled counselors' presence within the field. And so as a disabled academic and counselor, I share my story to increase access. And Lynn, what about barrier reduction?
Yeah, so I think that this, one of the key pieces to me is really that if we can increase the presence of disabled counselors in training, disabled academics, this increases a pipeline to a better, higher quality of access to care for disabled individuals, right? And so we see the flip side of this a lot in academia, I think. I'll talk a little bit more about academic ableism, but we're in these structures that inherently weed people out because of how hostile and how inaccessible the environment is. And this is self-perpetuating. Right? If there are no disabled people in a space because it's inaccessible or because there are a high number of social barriers to enter that space, then traditionally what we have seen is that there's very little advocacy for accessibility and for disability justice and disability equity outside of people with held identity. And so all of a sudden there are no voices advocating for accessibility or even noticing it. We'll talk about ableism and ability privilege some too, right? And so this becomes this self-perpetuating circle where then it's the argument is, well, there are no disabled people here, so why would we make it accessible? And if we can't get in the door, then naturally we are not there to be counted and to have this be something that becomes a priority. So in order to do this, A, we got to recognize that not all of the disabilities are visible. And that people absolutely have the right to choose when and how and to whom and under what circumstances they disclose disability, whether it's apparent or not, because I often present very much unavoidably disabled. I don't get a lot of choice when I'm using my wheelchair and my service dog, and certainly get very intrusive questions, which is kind of its own other level of disclosure, right? So shouldn't be necessary to disclose. That's part of the really proactive barrier reduction approach, is that we are empowering people to the same level of self-determination that we would be providing any of our other students or clients, for them to choose when they want to engage in that conversation or to bring that up. Sorry, lost my mouse for a moment. All right, so ableism in higher ed and counseling. I gave myself 5 minutes or less. I'm going to keep to it because this could be its whole own presentation, maybe multiple presentations. This goes really, really, really deep. So ableism, the most obvious definition is just that this is favoring able-bodied individuals over disabled individuals. Ableism is rooted fundamentally in eugenics and in fear, right? Like deep-seated societal fear. Fear of contagion, fear of difference, fear of death, fear of medical interventions, all of these different things, right? And so ableism can be a very overt kind of bias. It can also be a very covert normalizing able-bodiedness. So when I taught Disability Culture 100 to undergraduates, I spent the first 4 months of every semester, which is pretty much the whole semester, right? Three months at least, literally just correcting people using normal in their case conceptualization contrasts, right? So Susie needs this particular accommodation and a normal student wouldn't necessarily. And I'm like, all right, so we got to go way, way back here, right? So there's this real attitude, right, that ability is normative. Disability culture flips that on its head. And you'll hear, anybody know the acronym TAB? T-A-B? So TABs are temporarily able-bodied people, which is sometimes what we all call you in private if you're not part of disability community. Because this is, from our stance, at least from my like very CRIP culture, very identity-focused stance, which I'll unpack a little bit more in a minute, this is a very normative part of a human experience, right? Whether it's temporary or permanent, to some degree or other, it is very likely that all of us are going to be disabled in some way, shape, or form at some point in our life. And so this real arm's length approach, I don't think serves any of us. Higher ed is its own kind of challenge because higher ed has been inaccessible from the start. We've got the rolling quads in the 80s in California being told that they tried cripples before and it didn't work out and they couldn't come to the university. And they were literally having friends lifting their wheelchairs up over curbs at Cal Berkeley. So the environment has always been inaccessible. It behooves the academic structure to keep out disability. And I think that that's something that we fundamentally, especially I'm seeing a lot of educators in the chat, something that we fundamentally need to understand. The existence of higher education necessitates the creation of lower education, and disability has always been a part of that lower education. We literally had people, disabled children, often being starved and researched on in university basements well into the 80s. If I am in a university structure, I am certainly not supposed to be on the third floor in my department coordinator's office. I'm supposed to be in the basement being studied on. That is the inherent structure, right? That is where the system is rooted. So I think it's really important for us to understand that. And that's a lot of the tension and the friction that you get when you start advocating even for pretty basic accommodations in a university setting, because there really is this very protective urge, I think, of the system because of how it's rooted. In counseling practice, unfortunately, a whole lot of our counseling spaces are not accessible. And just because you work in a hospital doesn't mean it's accessible. We know that medicine is very inaccessible. A lot of private practice, inaccessible. I worked with a supervisor during my internship where we had to figure out what the plan was if I had a bad day, because she was in a brownstone with a second floor office and no elevator. It's a historic building, right? So there's all of these pieces that all kind of contribute to even just our physical spaces being inaccessible. And then there's a lot of gaps in training. So Feather and Carlson did this study talking to counselor educators to determine how successful we were in appropriately training our students. And it's something like 30% thought that they did at least like a moderate job in their program of preparing students to work with disability. Again, this is 25% of the population, right? So that number really needs to be close to 100% when we're talking about a quarter of the population that our students are potentially not prepared to serve. They also found that counselor educators were much more likely to endorse self-efficacy with teaching disability competencies when they had their own disability lived experience, or, you know, someone in their family had experienced a disability. And then the profession is fairly inaccessible. And so we don't end up with a lot of representation, right? So these are really just kind of compounding issues. You may have noticed, have a CRC and an LPC. My master's was in clinical mental health, and then I did my rehabilitation training as a doctoral student. I consider myself to have experience in both settings, not just clinical rehabilitation, but very much so in traditional rehabilitation and in clinical mental health. I see really, really different ableism in those two places. So in rehabilitation, often it is that I'm the identified client. And even though it's very subconscious, right, there's this kind of shock of me showing up as a peer or as a colleague. In counselor ed and more traditional clinical mental health kind of spaces, the most common reaction that I get when I bring up this topic is, wow, I'd never thought of it that way. And I'm sorry, but we have an ethical mandate to be thinking of it, right? Because this is part of multiculturalism. Yes, I'm also seeing in chat, very much so, inspiration porn. So those of us who are in the spaces and are representing disability often are told how inspirational we are for doing the work. And it's really ironic in these settings, because the work that I am doing for the most part is so that I will be able to tolerate staying in the field. But we also get a lot of just accolades for literally waking up in the morning, because like what could possibly be worse than having a disability is very much the societal attitude, right? Because of how ableist our society is.
So this is a quote that I found, I love this quote. Occupying disability means that I embody it. I occupy myself with disability and I am occupied by it. I can't shake it, so I embrace it. The only way to have relationships that get past disability is to fully claim it. Once you make the effort to fully occupy it, then it can disappear. And then it has like a poem, and I am a poet. And so a lot of disability culture, when I started researching, I found a lot of writings and art within disability culture, and it made me feel seen, heard, and validated. And this is a text that I can relate to. And by the way, when I was growing up, I didn't know this, but a lot of times when I was getting discrimination for having a disability, being made fun of, when I was in middle school, in high school, a lot of it, that's how I became a writer, is that I wrote poetry and it was like my therapy. And so I identify with disabled artists and disabled poets. And if I were to do anything in my research or my therapy modality, I would like to introduce poetry as therapy and for disability identity, because this is who I am. I embody it. So the text reads, the poem reads, a reduction is a synthesis, words, letters that falling from the sky, raining art, text rain, my life in pictures, my philosophy. I was so lucky to get interested in dance early on. In my liberation practices, I saw the disabled body become free. And so that quotation right there, that poem. That's how I feel about writing. Every time I come to a page or the blank piece of paper, I find myself, I am liberated. And with further ado, we're ready to go to the next slide.
Cool. So I promised a little bit on crip culture. Crip culture is a reclamation of the word cripple, but we see it in slang a lot in community spaces, even that don't necessarily align super strongly with disability pride movements and identity forward movements. You'll hear crip time and all of these other kind of pieces. So it's I think it's invasive. And I use that word intentionally, which is a good thing to my mind. I think it's a good way to flip the script. So I've got a couple of videos, but I also wanted to draw your attention to Criptiques. So I use this in some of my teaching. It's a compilation edited by Caitlin Woods, and it's all lived experience. It's people who align with Crip culture. A lot of it is meant to be spoken word. So one of the introductory pieces, I'm just going to read briefly. Crip is my favorite four-letter word. Succinct and blunt, profane to some, Crip packs a punch. Crip is unapologetic, audacious, non-compliant. Crip takes pleasure in its boldness and utter disinterest in appearing respectable to the status quo. It's a powerful self-descriptor, a cultural signifier, and a challenge to anyone attempting to conceal disability off in the shadows. Crip is anti-assimilationist and proud of it. Crip is outspoken with no patience for nonsense. Crip is my culture and it's where I want to be. So a lot of this movement is inherently rebellious. This is, and I'm about to play the trailer for Crip Camp. Anybody seen Crip Camp? If you haven't, please go watch it. It's in our toolkit and we're going to watch the trailer together. But Judy Heumann is featured in the trailer and in the documentary. And I always think when I think of Crip culture, I think of Judy Heumann gave a TED talk about 8 years ago where she asked the audience, how many people does it take to stop traffic in the middle of New York City in rush hour? Well, it takes 50 is what they found out during the civil rights protests. But how many people does it take to stop a bus in New York City if they won't let you on it because of your wheelchair? And she says it takes one, because you roll up with your wheelchair and you put it right in front of the stairs. And if you shove it just right, they can't move their bus. So this is kind of the attitude behind the Crip movement. And I'm going to hope that my embedded videos work.
What, you want me to tell them what happened? Well, two people got cramps and they're spinning.
We were all very hyper about it.
And I have to go shower some people. I'll see you later.
I wanted to be part of the world, but I didn't see anyone like me in it.
I hear about a summer camp for the handicapped run by hippies. Somebody said you probably will smoke dope with the counselors. And I'm like, sign me up.
Up to Camp Jeanette and find yourself.
There I was in Woodstock.
You wouldn't be picked to be on the team back home, but at Jeanette, you had to go up the bat.
Even when we were that young, we helped empower each other. It was allowing us to recognize that the status quo is not what it needed to be.
The world always wants us dead. We live with that reality.
At the time, so many kids just like me were being sent to institutions. It was just a continual struggle.
Most disabled people, like myself, are unable to use public transportation.
We needed a civil rights law of our own.
A rehabilitation program has been vetoed by the president because it was cost prohibitive.
We decided we were going to have a demonstration.
You get the call to action, to the barricades.
A small army of the handicapped have occupied this building for the past 11 days.
So many people from Camp Jeanette found their way into the building.
The FBI cut off the phones. The deaf people went, we know what to do. That's how we communicated to the people outside the building. The Black Panther Party would bring a hot meal. We were like this.
We are the strongest political force in this country.
We will no longer allow the government to oppress disabled individuals. And I would appreciate it if you would stop shaking your head in agreement when I don't think you understand what we are talking about.
What we saw at that camp was that our lives could be better.
you don't demand what you believe in for yourself, you're not gonna get it.
I said for pleasure.
Do you like to see handicapped people depicted as people?
Excuse me?
So I think when that came out, like, there was just joy in the disability community, right? It was the first time, at least for me, it was the first time that I had seen myself depicted in that way, right? And I watched it like 3 times, texted everyone I knew. Like, it was that kind of an event within the disability community. So I think I've got a review on CSI on the counselor's bookshelf, and we've got it linked in the resources. Please do check it out if you are interested. So the other piece to this, I think, for me, is really this broader disability arts and how it looks very, very different when you're in these spaces. And I'm going to let this pretty much stand on its own, but Kinetic Light is a dance troupe based in California in the Berkeley area. And I use this video because it is an example of what it would look like if we were taking a barrier reduction approach from the beginning and making sure that things just would be usable by everybody from the start.
Hovering just above the ground in her wheelchair by an aerial point, a white dancer, Laurel, launches into spins with her hand. The crew sets up.
We are doing this because we have faith and trust and love for each other.
A Black sign language interpreter, Brandon. Alice, a Black dancer in a wheelchair, soars. Jerron, a Black dancer, traces circles in flight. A duet midair, Alice and Laurel spin. By the sea, the three dancers each smile directly into the camera. Back in a large dance studio, a panel of opaque windows. Each dancer explores stillness and movement with aerial cables, rehearsing on different days, rolling slowly, holding, arching backward, head nearly touching the ground, twisting high in the air, bouncing, a spider drawn up into its web, an unhurried turn on one foot, gleeful spinning. Laurel and Alice floating, clasp arms, pull in, push away, and float out of view. 1+1 = 3, featuring Kinetic Light, directed by Catherine Helen Fisher. Past, present, future, with captions, ASL, audio description, allarts.org, at allartstv.
I always also think of the backlash with Netflix when they released Daredevil, which of course is about a blind superhero, and had no audio description available at the release, right? So just that really proactive, accessible, and usable environment. All right, so very, very quickly, I find that disability models in general aren't taught outside of rehab. So A, be aware that there are disability models and that maybe you might want to educate yourself on them. But I also find that so often that list is the medical and moral models, which we know are outdated. Maybe a charity model gets thrown in there. Somebody might know about an employment model if they're more vocationally focused. We might get all the way to like a social or an ecological or a biosocial model. Very rarely are we talking about even a cultural model. And certainly we are almost never yet in our field talking about affirming models. So these are beginning to emerge. They're emerging from research. They're emerging either from participatory research or from looking at what disability community is doing and trying to put those things into a framework. Makes a lot of sense, right? So this is a really, I think, a new area, and it's not getting implemented even when these models do get proposed. And so I think this is a great opportunity, those of you who are interested in research and advocacy, right? This is an area where it would need this shift to working with disability community and disability culture, where often, you know, we talk about, there's this disability studies joke that it's disability studies rather than disability studied, like all the other fields. But that's kind of where we are, right? That disability has been something to be studied, not a partnership with our field to determine best care. So disability justice is a community movement. This is straight from disability advocates, disability artists. And it really centers access and self-determination. This is a lot of what I'm using in my advocacy right now, because I think that there is room for us to shift and grow with this. But certainly these are some pretty solid principles that we can use to determine whether our advocacy work is going to be disability affirming or not. So intersectionality, you can see from the Crip Camp video how diverse this community is and always has been, and that's always been celebrated within the disability community. leadership of the most impacted. Nothing about us without us was the civil rights slogan. And we consistently find that when we're excluded from the decision-making process, it does not go well for us. So leadership of the most impacted, we should have a voice. We are the ones that the policies impact. Anti-capitalism, cross-movement organizing, ensuring that we're collaborating with other DEI and multicultural spaces, recognizing wholeness, sustainability of the movement, cross-disability solidarity. So a little bit of what we're doing today, right? That people who have different disability needs are able to work together, and that we're able to navigate through the fact that there will be conflicting access needs. And there will be places where we are having a little bit of friction, in addition to those places where we can learn from one another and really embracing that process. Interdependence. So this is really the idea that, you know, there's this concept that disabled people need to be fully autonomous. That's not necessarily true. We're advocating for community care, right? We're advocating for full inclusion and the ability to be interdependent with society, with each other, with non-disabled people. Collective access and collective liberation. So this is really, nobody's getting left behind. You know, in the protests in the 70s and 80s in New York over the subway system, if somebody showed up at an inaccessible subway system, they were sending people to drag that wheelchair up the stairs, right? You're not leaving anybody behind. And that was before we had social media. So I think we could do a much better job now of coordinating and ensuring that we're all going to make it to a better space.
So this is really my passion, is building access within education. And I was 5 years old when I was diagnosed with a disability, hearing loss. And so I didn't really see myself in school. In K through 12, I had no access. I didn't have any accommodations until I was in college. So when I look at access, I look at the historical education discrimination, and this pretty much sums it up. This is a big part of disability movement. So access intimacy, which was introduced in the early 2010s by Mia Mingus. She's part of the BIPOC, community. She said, having access is seeing light, loving, feeling. It brings the people who are a part of it closer. It builds and deepens connection. Sometimes access intimacy doesn't mean that everything is 100% accessible. Sometimes it looks like both of you are trying to create access as hard as you can with no avail in an ableist world. Sometimes it is someone just sitting and holding your hand while you both stare at an inaccessible world. And the next one is the fear of being left by the people you love who are supposed to love you. The pain of staring or passing, the sting of disappointment, the exhaustion of having the same conversation over and over again, the throbbing fullness of getting your hopes up and the shrinking of yourself in order to maintain, is echoing loneliness, part shame, part guilt, part constant apology and thank you. And I'm just going to just say this very briefly. These two, access and intimacy in that quote I read before, those are very valid issues to be discussing with clients that are in the disability community, because access, that's a big part of being seen and heard. And so just having somebody to hold your hand and sit with you, that's a love recipe. And I could go on and on and on, but I'm gonna pass it on to Lynn.
Yeah, and I think the only thing I would add on access intimacy is, you know, a lot of us in the community feel and experience this very, very deeply. So how I kind of sum this up is the initial I am you, you are me, that you experience when you meet somebody else, either with similar disability needs or just in general, having that oppressive experience that we often encounter. And it does, it forms very, very quick, very, very fast bonds. And I would argue that it's one of the reasons that we need to do better with accessibility, especially in our training, you know, in counselor ed, so that we have more counselors in training who make it through, because right now, a lot of them are not. We're weeding people out who we really need client-facing and student-facing, because there is something to be said for, I have never had a mentor who presents as I present. I don't have anybody who I can go to and say, hey, how did you navigate job search with a wheelchair? Right. So that's a missing piece. And it does forge those deep connections.
So this is something that we did with Love. We created an ARCA toolkit to build disability affirmative counseling education. And here are some suggestions that we have. Number one, evaluate your own biases and work on them. And this is a intervention. This is something that I made. Look at the Washington Post. There is a bias quiz that you can take. So that's something that will identify, hey, what's my bias? And then once you know that, you can work on it. Number two, learn more about what ableism and what inclusive teaching is, and we be lead for inclusion. And there's the website. Toni Say, who is not here, she's part of our accessibility task force. She helped create Lead for Inclusion, and she's got some wonderful resources within there. And then number three, build your counseling toolbox. Read or listen to stories, a disabled community, a tangible intervention, a book recommendation is Being Human, an unrepentant memoir, Judy Human. And Judy has a podcast called Being Human, and there is a link in the chat, not in the chat, the webs. And then number four, build disability cultural competency. We have the ARCA accessibility report. It is listed there, where it is. And then we also recommend disability related counseling competency. This is also on the ACA website. This came about in 2018, 2019. And then we also have a disability culture handout, and Dr. Pierce, she created this. And so
you're welcome to it.
This is something that you can review, and this is about disability culture. And so, Lynn, if you want to speak more about that, you can.
Yeah, it's a bunch of resources. It's a live handout, so you're welcome to bookmark it or download it. The bit.ly links are all on there so that you can access it again and make sure that it's, you know, you're using the up-to-date version. It's also got a link out to a whole list of handouts that I'm making, some of which are on accessible instruction. I saw some interest in that in the chat, and some other topics, similar topics. So you're welcome to use any of those. And that concludes our content. So I think we might have a couple minutes for questions. Yeah, so I am not exactly sure what the best way to get the slide deck to you is, but I'm sure that CSJ will let us know.
Was working readily to get myself back here. Yes, so thank you all. Please put your questions in the chat as you already have been. And yes, we will, once the Q&A is done, I'll tell you a little bit more about how we'll make all the materials available to you all.
And I see our main question right now is getting connected with other disabled counselors and people interested in disability justice. So I knew we'd be short on time, so I didn't do too much on it at the start, but the committee that I run, the Disability Justice and Accessibility Committee through the ACES DIN, has a disability community space as part of that. We also have been mobilizing at conferences. So like at ACES, we had a group me going so that if people ran into a challenge at the conference or just needed support, that we could do that for one another. It's a great space. So please just reach out to me. My email is on this slide and it's in the slide deck and I'm easy to find with a Google search, my name and Mercer. Reach out to me, let me know that you'd like to get involved with that and I'll get you the information for our spring meetings. So I see another question in the chat. Resources for working with people with disabilities who are in the geriatric population. I received a lot of training on working with disabled persons who fall into this age group. I would be looking at ageism stuff in addition to ableism resources. It's interesting to me because I don't know of a lot of things that are specific to geriatric populations and disability. However, there is often an assumption that people who are disabled are going to be elderly. It's this weird thing that happens. So I don't have a lot of good specific resources. If the person asking that question wants to get in touch with either of us, though, we're happy to do some research and help you filter things. Recommendations for addressing attendance policies that disproportionately impact disabled students in our field. So I would work with, this may be biased because I was part of disability services. Thank you, whoever just put the Disability Justice and Accessibility Committee info in the chat. So I was part of SDR for too long. I would work with your disability services or your access and accommodations office, see if they have any recommendations because our programs in particular can get really, really tricky just because of some of the KCREP requirements. And so they or your general counsel's office at your university may have some more ideas for what you can do to really adhere to your ethics and also make sure that you're not jeopardizing accreditation.
Beautiful. I also see that there is, notice of the Disability Justice and Accessibility Committee meeting. Yes, Dr. Bernardo Johnson, is this, could you tell us exactly where we might be able to participate?
Yes, so I can get the link to people, but that is the date and time. So thank you. Thank you, Chantrell. I would not have remembered that off the top of my head. So thanks for keeping me honest.
You're welcome. I was going to put the meeting information, but it's too long to put it in the chat.
Yeah, that Zoom link is going to be real awkward. So if you want to just email me and I'll put my email into the chat too for those who might need it and I'll get you connected with myself and my co-chair and then you'll get the spring information. We're done with meetings for fall, but we'll be starting back up in January.
Wonderful. My goodness. I'll pause here because I know we are right at time, but I just want to thank the two of you all so much. You are engaging and doing exceptional work. You're encouraging all of us to think more intentionally about what inclusive practice looks like with disability culture and all of the work that we need to do together in counselor education. So thank you so much for sharing your information with us. I'm going to put once again the survey for CEs inside of our chat. Please make sure that you fill out this survey so that we have some feedback about our presentation and the work and the exploration that we're doing together here with Counselors for Social Justice. And once again, give all of your celebrations to our presenters today for their wonderful work. If you are curious about the materials, if the presenters are open to sharing, what I will do is once I upload the video for this particular chat, I'll also upload a link to where you may be able to access the slides for this particular presentation. So keep an eye out on the CSJ website or YouTube channel so that you can gain access to our videos, to our information and our presentation slides as well. Thank you all so much for being here. We are so excited for all the many ways in which we are highlighting the advocacy needs within our field. And we hope to continue to do so and to engage in a lot more of this inclusive, accessible, and intersectional work. So with that, I'll send you all off. But thank you so much for all of your work and your time. And we look forward to seeing you at the next webinar. Take care, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.